Good afternoon, everybody. Brother Lloyd here. And to all my Sabbath keepers, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you are all having a wonderful and blessed Sabbath day. Now, step four, baptism by the Spirit. We're going to talk about spiritual baptism, and we're going to talk a little bit about water baptism because it plays an important part. So we're going to jump right in with Matthew 3:2, which reads, "And said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now this was John, and he was saying to change our hearts and our mind from evil or sin to good. Romans 6 verses 5 through 7 read, "For if we be planted with him to the similitude of his death, even so shall we be the similitude of his resurrection." Now pay very close attention to two small words, if and shall. It says, "For if, even so shall." The word "if" is a conditional clause. The Father makes no presumption in his word that we're going to uphold our end of the bargain. He keeps all of his promises. Verse 6 reads, "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we shall not serve sin." I'm going to point out some of these small words because people read right through them. Thus, it blurs the understanding of what the word is conveying to us. The definition of "might" is simply the past tense of "may." So if we reread verse 6, it reads, "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we shall not serve sin." It doesn't mean "will be." It says "might be." This again is another conditional situation. Many things we want and desire from the Father are conditional on us doing our part to receive them. So when we do our part, the "shall" kicks in. If, then this shall happen. If we don't do our part, that shall not happen. So we have to understand when we're reading the Father's word that there are a lot of conditions based on our choice. Verse 7, "For he that is dead is freed from sin." So if we freely give up this sin to our Savior, to the Almighty, we will be free from the slavery of it, and it will have no power over us. And the question is why? Well, because we now draw our strength from him, and we stop relying on self. So once we start drawing our power from the Almighty, sin has no power over us. And then finally, verse 13 reads, "Neither give ye your members as weapons of unrighteousness unto sin, but give yourselves unto God as they that are alive from the dead, and give your members as weapons of righteousness unto God." So this verse is telling us what to do simply because it is all conditional and the choice is ours. I'm going to pound that fact, and I'm going to keep pounding it, because everything by us and for us is about our choice. But the Father will never take away our freedom of choice. He created us with free will. But when it comes to things like being baptized, all of a sudden people think that the Father, through the Holy Spirit, is just going to take over our life and sanctify us and have us live righteously for the rest of our lives, even if we haven't chosen to surrender all to Him to do so. Well, the bottom line, it's not going to happen like that. What we find is that if we choose Him, He empowers us in our choice. For instance, each time a temptation comes along, it will get easier and easier each successive time to rebuke it or to resist it as long as we continue to choose Him. Why? Because He strengthens us more and more each time we choose Him until that desire is no longer in us. And moreover, if we choose the sin, it gets tougher and tougher each time to refuse that temptation, because now we are more easily influenced by the enemy and the temptation because we didn't resist it the first time or the last time. So the more and more you accept either or, the stronger you get in either or direction. So you might want to choose the righteous way because you become stronger in rebuking the enemy. And with the sin, you don't realize how much farther away from the Father you are until you try to get back from the sin that you've chosen to accept, especially if it's a repeated sin, because if it's repeated, it gets tougher and tougher each time to resist it because it has a stronger and stronger grip on you. And every time you try and get back to the Father, there's a higher price to pay because you have to be proven that much more to overcome it. And it's all because we choose to do so. We choose that sin. John tells us to change our hearts and mind from evil to good. Like I said in Matthew 3:2, he says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now, John was and is a key figure in us understanding what baptism is all about. He even shows us by baptizing the Savior. But even in baptizing the Savior by water, he emphasizes that the baptism by the Holy Spirit is far more significant than water baptism because it's the inward change or conversion that he's referring to. See, John was baptizing us to lead us to change. And this is just outward. But see, we can choose to not do so and go right back into the worldly lifestyle that we have always been living and not receive the spiritual conversion or the inward change by the Holy Spirit. And that's what we're truly seeking. See, our choice of surrendering all to the Father makes that difference. If John baptizes us, if your pastor baptizes you, if someone baptizes you in water, the outward baptism, which is supposed to lead you, but you go right back into the world, you won't receive the spiritual baptism within because you've chosen to refuse that by going back to the world. The Father is not going to force the Holy Spirit on any of us. It's our choice that makes the difference. In John 1, he tells us what he witnessed, starting with verse 29, which reads, "The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said, Behold, that Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." See, John recognized him as that Lamb of God. Verse 30, "This is he whom I said, after me cometh a man, which was before me, for he was better than I, and I knew him not, but because he should be declared to Israel, therefore am I come baptizing with water." So John bare record, saying, "I beheld that Spirit come down from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him, and I knew him not. But he that sent me to baptize with water, he said unto me, Upon whom thou shalt see that Spirit come down, and tarry still on him, that is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is that Son of God." So John recognized Christ to be the Son of God by the appearing of the Spirit coming down upon him. So let's look at Acts. We should all know Acts 2, 1 through 4. Most people do in some form or another. This is where the Holy Spirit came down as cloven tongues of fire and baptized. And verse 4 reads like this, "And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." So now they spoke in different tongues or languages as the Holy Spirit directed them to spread the gospel. They were not giving any secret or non-understandable tongue reserved for any special group to understand. Remember, the enemy always produces a counterfeit for everything that the Father has, merely to create confusion and deceive the Father's children. So when people talk about speaking in these unknown languages and tongues that only a select few or their group can understand, that is a lie from the enemy who perpetrated it. Acts 2:17 tells us that this will also happen again in the last days. But Peter tells us in Acts 2:38 this, Then Peter said unto them, amend your lives, or repent, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift, of the Holy Ghost. So to receive the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost is a gift from the Father. Now, the thief on the cross is a riveting example of baptism, conversion, and being saved all in one example. We're told that in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Then we're told in John 1:13 that the Word was made flesh. So Christ is the Word made flesh, who is also God. And by Him, we can receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So repentance and remission of sins in Christ are two examples of the Word, and therefore of our salvation. And they are obtained by the promise, understood or perceived by what? Faith, and are formalized in us through baptism. That's how we receive that promise. That's how it is fulfilled. And this will only occur if we truly surrender. I'm telling you, people, surrendering is the most important thing. Because if we don't surrender, nothing will change, because spiritual conversion will not take place in us. We have to surrender. Now, back to the thief on the cross. What happened to him? Now, everyone loves referencing this. Luke 23, everyone loves to reference it. But many of us need to sit back and really analyze the different aspects of it over and over and over, because there's so many things in there. But this time we're going to sit back and look at a couple of these layers. Let's go to Luke 23, verse 39. It reads, and one of the evildoers which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be that Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answered and rebuked him, saying, fearest thou not God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? Verse 41 reads, we are indeed righteously here, for we receive things worthy of that we have done, but this man have done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Then Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto you, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Now, by the one thief rebuking the other and acknowledging his sins to the Almighty and recognizing that Christ was God, there was a true spiritual conversion in him, and the Savior outwardly acknowledged it by granting the repentful thief's request or petition. The thief was baptized by the Word, literally by the Word. That was a spiritual baptism, and our Savior promised him that on that day he would be with him in paradise. He didn't say he would be in paradise on that day. He was making the promise to him on that day. This conversion, this spiritual baptism, saved this thief from the second death, but not from his present condition. He was going to die, and he was going to be buried, just like many of us. We're going to die and be buried, and we're going to await the second coming. But let's address the first thief's comment for a moment. He said, if thou be that Christ, save thyself and us. Now, he was only concerned with himself and his predicament. See, he wanted to get out of that predicament, that situation he was in. He had no faith or belief in Christ. But this brings to mind so many of us even today. See, so many today are like that unrepentful thief on the cross, only calling on the Father when things are working against them, or only when things are going bad, or only when you're in trouble, only when you need something, blah, blah, murmur, murmur, complain, complain. And what's the end result? 2 Chronicles 15:2, which reads, and if ye seek him, he will be found of you. But if ye forsake him, he will forsake you. We have to be a seeker of the Father so that he may find us. Like I said, not just when things are working against us, but always, always, even when things are going good, we have to be a seeker of him, to thank him and praise him and all the things that we should be doing, not just when it's convenient for us. And back to something I said last week, I don't recommend the second thief's approach to a conversion either, because you may die suddenly and not have time to repent, because you may not be hanging on a cross with ample time to do so before you die. You may die suddenly. But in spite of that, man teaches this type of repentance, which basically says, in a rebellious way, that you can live your life any way you want, and then on your deathbed, if you're so blessed to be on a deathbed, you can call your pastor, priest, bishop, or whoever you follow, and they can absolve you of your sins and grant you your forgiveness, which save you. Here we go again with the enemy perverting something that the Father says is not true. We are taught in many scriptures that only through faith and belief in Christ are our sins forgiven by the Father, not man. Through Christ, by the Father, not man. Man cannot forgive sins. But many lean on John 20 and 23 to support that erroneous teaching. And John 20, 23 reads, "Whosoever's sin ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained." This was Jesus speaking to his disciples just prior to his departure. But let's go back and look at verses 21 and 22 again before we explain what it means. 21 reads, "Then said Jesus unto them again, Peace be unto you. As my Father sent me, so I send you. And when he had said that, he breathed on them and said unto them, Receive the Holy Ghost." And then verse 23 again reads, "Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whoever sins ye retain, they are retained." So to explain, what he did was to endow his disciples with the power of the Holy Spirit. He breathed unto them the Holy Spirit. This gave them the ability to discern. This gave them the ability to discern whether someone was truthful or not in their faith claim and honestly tell them whether or not their sins were forgiven. They were not claiming to be able to forgive sin as men do today. So by the gift of the Holy Spirit, if you claim a certain thing, they could say that you are forgiven of your sins because they could discern that, because they had the power to be able to do so, not forgive the sins. That's still about the Father and the Father only. So, what am I saying in terms of baptism is this. If you can be baptized by water by someone who is living for the Father in all the ways that you can trust and discern, by all means do so. But understand, though, that the water baptism is meant to lead us unto repentance and a change so that we may receive the spiritual baptism by the Holy Spirit, which is the spiritual conversion. Now, did the thief receive a water baptism? No. Did he receive a spiritual baptism? Yes, because he had true conversion in his mind and he truly repented in his heart. The Father could see that. Thus, he received a spiritual conversion and will be in heaven when that time comes. But don't get it confused. Man cannot forgive your sins. Water baptism doesn't convert you. Your surrendering all opens you to conversion by the Holy Spirit. And with that being said, let's talk about the mark of the beast. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.